to this edition of the Tent Makers Institute of the Kingdom Project. I'm glad to welcome us to this class as we will be discussing some very important understanding and knowledge that God would be sharing with us. The topic of this class is urban missions. And when we hear the word urban missions, I wouldn't know, different ideas might come to our mind, but we believe God that in this class, the Lord will be revealing to us his mind about the urban centers across the globe and his assignments, the responsibility, the expectation that God has laid on us as Christians at these last days to bring in much more harvest than ever before. In this class, we are going to have a brief introduction, and then we will look at some key terms that are very important when we discuss urban missions. We will also try and understand what are some common misconceptions that people have about urban missions. In addition to that, we will go ahead and look at biblical models for urban missions, that is, taking the case study of one or two great examples in the scriptures, like Apostle Paul, like Jeremiah, and we are going to infer lessons on how we as Christians should approach urban missions. Equally, we would be discussing how to develop an attraction for urban missions, because urban missions is very important to God. It's an initiative, it's an idea that the Lord is, you know, bringing to our consciousness in these last days, because there is a great need, a great demand for Christians in the urban centers to understand the mind of God for reaching the unreached in their communities, in their societies in these last days. Then we are going to be looking at what are the mission opportunities that we have in the urban centers. Also, we'll look at who is expected to participate in urban missions. We will be using Romans 10, 13 to 15. Iron Kate Falconer, where it says that I have but one candle of life to burn, and I'd rather burn it out in a land filled with darkness than in a land flooded. As Christians, we are light, and our light shines best when we allow the Spirit of God to lead us into places where light is not well into. And Jesus demonstrated it. He himself, the scripture recorded in Luke chapter 8 verse 1, how Jesus went from cities, right, to the towns around the period when he was ministering. And that sends a signal to us that God does not exempt cities when it comes to missions. We need to be conscious of that. Now, we would look at some terms when we talk about urban missions. I'm sure one of the things we might be looking at is what exactly is even urban. When we say urban, what are we trying to reference? What are we trying to say? When we say urban, this means something that is relating to or located in a city. So for some of us, maybe our workplaces, some of us where we live, some of us where we trade, we go and do business. All these places are typical of urban way of life. There are a lot of places that even before now were not necessarily urban in nature, but in the last few years, due to globalization, are becoming urban in nature. All these places are captured when we say urban. And then when we say urbanization, which is also another key term, we are talking about a process or a situation where something is being transformed to become urban in nature. And that is one of the things that is happening in a lot of our towns, in a lot of our cities right now. That is, urbanization is transforming and affecting places that ordinarily would not have qualified as a city. Changes are coming, development is coming in, technological advancement is coming in as well. And so almost every nation, every place on earth is experiencing urbanization. A lot of people across different geographical locations are experiencing new ways of doing things, the city way of doing things. So when we say urbanization, we're not just talking about a geographical location. We're talking more about the characteristics that you would find in a place, the characteristics that defines a place. So it's not just places maybe with high population. Yes, high density areas are also cities. Most times they are urban centers, but beyond even the high density areas, you have places that may not have the large population, but the way of life, the technological advancement, the changes happening is directly linked with urban centers. Those places are experiencing urbanization. So urbanization is happening even in local towns and places around us. And so, coming to the core of our class today, which is urban missions. What is urban missions? You see, urban missions is the act of taking the gospel message. When we say the gospel message, we are talking about the message of salvation through repentance and forgiveness of sin. So taking that gospel message to the unreached people hidden in various locations within the urban centers, within the urban cities, within the territories across the globe. And we've used one word here that is very key, that is hidden. When we say hidden, we are not talking about people who have been probably kept or people who have no road network to where they are. No, we are talking about hidden in the context of people's accessibility to the gospel. So hidden is used in this definition to refer to people whose probably their work or their way of life or their schedule or their lifestyle or even their location or their beliefs has kept them away from the easy reach and connection with the church. These are the hidden people in the context of urban missions. These are the people that God is expecting us to reach out to in the daily course of our activities at our workplaces, in our businesses. These people on a good day may never have gotten the chance to hear the gospel, but God is giving you the opportunity to go forth, trade, do business, get a job in those urban centers because he wants to bring the gospel to these people. These are the people we are referring to as the hidden people that God wants us to bring the salvation message to in urban missions. Now, there are some misconceptions that people have when we talk about urban missions, and we need to look at them and also correct them. One of the first misconceptions is that cities are not included in coverage of missions. So you typically see people say, if someone says they are missionary and they are going to a city, you could see sometimes even Christians ignorantly would just react like, missionary, what are you going to do in the city? Because there is a wrong mindset that when you say you're a missionary, you're expected to be in one of the most remote places on earth. That is a misconception because cities are very much in the coverage of missions. Also, some people feel that the church is doing enough already when it comes to city coverage for missions. They feel, you look at some typical cities and you see a lot of churches, a lot of Pentecostal and Orthodox churches, and there's just that misconception that, people in the city have enough gospel to go around. But that in itself is a misconception. Some also feel that cities generally are being well covered by churches. They feel because of this population of churches in the cities, there's a good coverage, so there's no need, right, for them to be bothered about how much souls have been saved in the city. That is another misconception. There's also the belief that there are no unreached communities within the cities. People would typically tell you, a city as large as that, they definitely everyone should have had the gospel. But that is a misconception, because the fact that a place is a city or an urban center does not automatically translate to every community within that city having heard the gospel. So the thought that there are no unreached cities, that there are no unreached communities within our urban areas is a misconception. You also see people have a mindset that those who are city-based missionaries, they are just enjoying, they are just relaxing. Oh no, those ones are not really doing much. That is a very wrong mindset. It is a very wrong misconception, because the challenges that are in urban missions are also significant, and it takes the Spirit of God, it takes the grace of God for a missionary in the city to succeed, because they are contending with a lot of things. So it's a wrong mindset, it's a misconception to think that those who are missionaries in urban centers and cities are not necessarily, being challenged. That is a wrong mindset. Also, people feel that missions is all about living in a place where there is no, social amenities, where there is no light. So the moment you are not necessarily talking of a very remote village, some have the wrong mindset that you are not talking about missions, but that is not true. And we will see some things that backs up the fact that these misconceptions we have mentioned are not correct in light of the scriptures. The first thing is that if we look at the Christian canon, it opens with mankind in a garden, true, but then it concludes with all the nations of the earth fellowshipping together with God in a city. That is Revelation chapter 21, verse 23 to 27. We can go through that. And so even though, yes, the Bible starts off with Adam and Eve in a garden, the same Bible wraps up with the people, nations coming together to worship God in a city. That gives us a full spectrum of God's expectation for missions. That both those who are in the rural environment, who may be in the garden in quotes, and those who are in the city, those who are in the large urban areas, are expected to be brought into the fold as children of God. Also, in the scripture, we have about 140 references to different cities. Some of them are Cain. In the Bible, in Genesis chapter 5 verse 17, he built the first city recorded and in the scriptures. We also have Abraham, who interceded for Sodom. That is Genesis chapter 18 verse 16 to 33, where Abraham was pleading that Sodom be not destroyed. Sodom was a big city at that time. We talk about Joseph in the scriptures, who administered a major city state during the time of famine in Egypt, which is still a well-known city as of today. Moses as well delivered the children of Israel from a city. They had labor in the city of Egypt. He delivered them and brought them out. The construction work they were doing, the laborious work they were doing, that was another example of someone who did a great work for God in the city. That's in Exodus chapter 5, Exodus chapter 12, all the way from 11, 12. We can see that storyline that explains how Moses was used to deliver the children of God in a city. Esther lived in a city at a great personal risk. She even participated in politics in the city just to bring about change, just to bring about the will of God in that city. We also have an example of Isaiah, for instance, that proclaimed God's word to the people. And he mentioned in verse chapter 61, verse 4, that God's people are going to be repairers of ruined cities. And that is one of the challenges God is laying ahead of us in this class. That as you are a Christian, what role, what part are you playing in repairing the ruins in the city where you find yourself? It could be moral decadence that is a ruin. It could be infrastructural decadence. It could be political decadence. But everything that represents ruin, God is expecting you as his own child to contribute to restoration wherever you find yourself in the city. And the way that is going to start is by taking the gospel out to people in these urban centers. Even Jesus' ministry cut across villages and cities. We referenced Luke 8:1 at the introduction. And then the church, which the Bible references the start, happened in the city of Antioch in Acts chapter 11. And so that in itself clearly shows that God is heavily interested in the city. He's heavily interested in urban centers. Paul, who wrote a large portion of the New Testament, was an urban missionary, if you put it. Going from Ephesus to Corinthians to Galatians. These were cities at the time, to Philippians. And you see how God used Paul's ministry work in the cities to bring about, you know, the strength of the early church. And then lastly, the seven churches that was even mentioned in Revelation chapter 2, chapter 3, these were city churches. So at the end of the day, what we can see from the narrative of the scriptures is that God's great commission assignment to us as Christians, it's not strictly to the local areas. It's not strictly to the villages. The commission assignment, the responsibility, the instruction that God gave us in the Great Commission is from villages to the city, across every spectrum. None is to be excluded. And oftentimes, opportunities come a lot in the city to witness the gospel. These are opportunities that if we are not sensitive, if we do not change those misconceptions which we've addressed, we might be limiting ourselves and how much God can use us to bring about restoration in those cities. Now we are going to pick some biblical models, which is like a template for us when we talk about urban missions. We're going to look at some biblical models from the life of Apostle Paul. We're going to look at Jeremiah as well. And when we look at Paul, we can see interestingly that he was even strategic in his urban mission. So the Bible recorded Paul, you know, visiting Athens, preaching in Athens. The Bible recorded Paul preaching in Corinth. The Bible recorded Paul preaching in Ephesus. And the Bible recorded Paul preaching in Rome as well, among other cities. Now, as at the time, Athens was actually like the intellectual center of the Greco-Roman world, its major city. Corinth was one of the commercial centers. In the context of maybe Nigeria, for example, you would talk of somewhere like Lagos, a major city where a lot of activities go on. That was one of the cities where Apostle Paul ministered. He also ministered in Ephesus, which is like a center of many pagan cults. So you talk about the religious center at the time. And then Rome was like the capital of the empire, the political capital, the military headquarters. These were major cities where Apostle Paul preached the gospel, where Apostle Paul brought about transformation, where he brought light, his light, the light of God in him to bear. Now, if we look at what Paul has done by reaching the cities, he was able to reach the whole society. And the way it works is, when you minister to people in the city, oftentimes there's a lot of interaction between those in the city and those in the neighboring communities or villages or towns. So when you're able to bring about someone to know God, maybe from your interaction with the person in the city, that person probably has a link to a number of people in the towns around, in the villages around. And so as you win that soul to God, to Jesus, the person goes back. Maybe they came to trade or do something in the city. They go back to their own base and they become light bearers. So even though you've not been to the next town or the next village or the next community, you, by ministering to someone in the city, you have sent a representative of God to go ahead and bring about transformation. If you look at the letter Paul wrote to the people in Colossae, that is in the book of Colossians, Paul was following up disciples in places such as Laodicea, Hierapolis, and other places in which he had never personally visited. But he was able to follow them up because the people he had witnessed to in Ephesians and Corinthians had taken the gospel to these interior parts. And so even though Paul didn't have to, by leg, get to the interior parts, the gospel of Jesus was able to get there by the work Paul had done in the urban centers. So that serves as a great example for us. We look at Jeremiah as well. And the book of Jeremiah 29 verse 7 is a very, very powerful scripture. The Bible says in Jeremiah 29, 7, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. It's a powerful scripture. If there's anything to challenge us, to encourage us to participate in urban missions, I think this is one of the scriptures. Because when we look at this passage, urban Christians depend on this scripture as much as we depend on the Great Commission in Matthew 28 verse 19. The commission is achieved through the relationships we maintain across workplaces, church and schools, and deliberate investment in intercessory prayer. And so what we need to understand is that when we want a change, when we want a transformation, when we want a restoration, a lot of us complain sometimes about the country we find ourselves, the cities we find ourselves, the states we find ourselves. God is saying in Jeremiah 29:7 that change, that transformation you desire in that place I have placed you, in that multinational company I have placed you, in that city and urban center I have placed you, in that center of trade I have placed you, that transformation you're looking for, it's not going to happen unless you take up the responsibility I've given you, which is the Great Commission. And oftentimes, we realize that as Christians, when we fail to do God's assignment, it comes back to bite us or haunt us, if I'll put it that way. Because when Jeremiah is saying that, in the peace of where I've sent you, that is where you get your own peace. Essentially, if we as Christians keep mute, if we don't take the gospel to people around us, the traders, the colleagues, these are the same people that, because they are not saved, will do things that might affect us negatively. As God would be committing into our hands greater responsibilities to take the gospel messages to urban centers, one of the key things we need to, you know, embrace and keep in our mind is the need to be sensitive. We need to be culturally sensitive like Apostle Paul. Because when you get to the city, you find people of diverse opinion. You find people of different backgrounds. You find people who have different mindsets. And so in order to reach out to these people, it is important that we also, by the leading of the Holy Spirit, we are flexible. And so the approach you will use to speak to someone, maybe you're in a city and you meet someone from a different culture, a different ethnic background, the way you would communicate with the person is not the same way you would communicate if you were to meet someone from your own locality, which is more common or more likely in a village or in a town setting. So ability to understand these differences and allow the Spirit of God to work in us, to relate with people even in their own differences, is one of the keys that would unlock a lot of hearts for Christ in urban centers. Look at Paul, for instance. When he was in Philippi, he reached different people through a Bible study group. But then he got to Athens, where there were intellectuals, and he reached them through scriptural tours. In Corinth, he reached laborers through his job as a tent maker. So we are seeing different approaches for different locations. And this is very important. One of the things that is key when you're trying to get someone into a Christian conversation, into a gospel conversation, is the ability to connect with the person. And you would only be able to do that when you are sensitive to the differences that you would encounter in people's position, disposition, way of communication in urban centers. That is something that is very, very important. And if we see the way God helped Paul, he was able to manage the differences. He applied different approach. He was sensitive. He was not rigid. When God is trying to use you in an urban center, we must be flexible, we must be malleable, we must be surrendered to the leading of the Holy Spirit. The Bible talks about the Spirit of God being like a wind blowing whithersoever it willeth. We must be flexible. That is how we can connect with different people in different circumstances. You are in a city, the way you would preach the gospel to someone you met in the market is not the same way you preach to someone that came to maybe your shop or your office. So there is need for flexibility, and the way we develop that flexibility is through further intimacy with the Holy Spirit. And so how do we develop attraction for urban missions? Because that is something that is also critical. When God builds in us an attraction, a desire for this, then we're able to do the work without much laborious effort. And so the way God has designed it is such that irrespective of whatever you do, that is your daily work, or whatever it is that generates income for you, or wherever you find yourselves within your urban communities and cities, you can make specific and deliberate decisions to participate effectively in missions. So you see a lot of people say, oh, it's the kind of job I do, that's why I'm able to participate in missions. You see some people say, oh, it's the kind of business I engage in, that's why I'm able to participate in missions. But the truth is, if we would allow the Spirit of God work in us, God has designed it such that even in that business, even in that corporate setting, even in that institution where you've gone for your master's, you can actually be a light bearer. You can actually bring the gospel of Christ to that environment. And so God is not saying every single one of us, we need to leave our careers and become full-time missionaries. No. But God is saying that we need to understand God's design for urban missions. And much more importantly, we need to submit to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Because let's not forget that the Holy Spirit still remains the God of the harvest. If you read Matthew 9, 37 to 38, you read 2 Timothy 3, 16 to 17, where it's talking about being the man of God being thoroughly furnished unto all good works. These scriptures clearly makes it obvious that we cannot discount away the importance of studying the scriptures, the importance of giving ourselves to the Holy Spirit if we are going to succeed in our missions in the city. And so one of the things that would help us understand city ministry, understand mission in the city, is that we first need to understand some distinguishing factors about cities from a missions perspective. Tim Keller did a very good job in a paper he presented at the Third Lutheran Congress. He highlighted three key distinguishing factors that must, you know, that we must be conscious of when we are dealing with cities. And these three factors actually make the cities great for missions. We can summarize them as cultural dynamism, global diversity, and individualism. I'll just touch on each of them briefly. So when we talk of cultural dynamism with regards to the city is known to have diverse cultures, is known to have established systems that provide opportunities to transform systems and institutions. You have a lot of opportunities to transform group of communities. There is a lot of social structure at the topmost level for Christ, which allows you to be able to impact things even from the topmost level because there's a structure in place. And so as a child of God, God gives you a big appointment. You are the chief executive officer, you are the chief financial officer of a large company. Oh, fantastic. By virtue of the nature of that position, you can influence a lot of the structure of the organization, a lot of structure of even the people you partner with in business for Christ. You can bring major big executives to the knowledge of Christ. And when that happens, what happens is there's a ripple effect. So a lot of people under that umbrella are being governed by those who have surrendered to Christ. And so the Holy Spirit has the overall control of those environments, those institutions. Another interesting thing about the city is global diversity. Most cities of the world host people from different nationalities, different people groups. So when you preach the gospel in the city, you are indirectly reaching multiple nations and platforms. So for instance, you find yourself in a major city like London, like Paris, or like Lagos, where there are different nationalities, and you give yourself to the work of ministry, the work of missions. What that means is that when you preach to someone maybe from an Italian background or someone from a French-speaking background, you have sown a seed to those countries. And that seed, you never can tell when and to what extent it will germinate. This is another thing that should make us excited, that should make us given to the work of missions in our cities. And then the third point, which perhaps might be one of the most important, is individualism. So, cities are generally fast-paced. Everybody's, you know, busy. Everybody has things to do. You have a lot of individuals and activity pursuing different things. So people tend to have their personal opinion in the city. People tend to have their personal beliefs, which governs people, in which governs their way of life, which governs their conduct. Individuals are likely to be more open-minded. Reason being that everyone is so busy focusing on their own that nobody has sufficient time to try and impose their opinion on others. Nobody has the time to try and monitor the activities of others. And so what that does is it leaves us with a set of people, city dwellers, who are not as strongly opinionated, people who are open to new ideas. And this is a very big opportunity for ministry. This is a very big opportunity for telling someone about the gospel. This freedom of opinion gives us the ability to engage urban dwellers because they are willing to, you know, reason, they are willing to open their minds to new things. And the gospel is the best new things. The Bible calls it good news. So because of this individualism, this concept where people have their own opinion, nobody is imposing another opinion on the other, people are more open to accept the gospel. When you engage a city dweller and you're able to, by the help of the Holy Spirit, make the person to see the need for Jesus in their lives, they are more willing to make a decision on a personal level without thinking, oh, what would the village chief say about this? Oh, what would the elders say about this? And that is a big advantage that we can use for the work of the ministry in our urban centers. The individualism, it is a big advantage. Sometimes you go for village outreaches and you've spoken to someone and you can see that the person is at the verge of giving their lives to Christ. But then they remember, oh, the rest of their family. They remember, oh, the chief, oh, the valet, and a host of other things. And that becomes another limitation or challenge that you have to overcome to get them to surrender for Christ. You hardly come across that in the city because everybody has their freedom. We need to also leverage on this. And this is one of the things that makes city ministry very, very attractive. Urban ministry in our time is actually set at the heart of the greatest transformation in human society in the history of the world. Why? The rate at which people are migrating to developed cities is increasing by the day, Christians inclusive. You see a lot of people going to developed communities, in America, in Europe, looking for better opportunities, looking for technology advancements, looking for wealth, looking for power. But in this process as well, there is poverty, there is depression, there is helplessness. But then, as change is accelerated, as there is a lot of transformation going on, there is a lot of opportunities and new doors of ministry, of missions that is opening up as well. And we as Christians in these cities, we need to take advantage. For instance, statistics shows that as at 1700, just about 2% of the world's population was living in urban places. By 1900, this became 9% of the world's population. As at 1950s, 27% of the world's population were living in urban cities. But by 1996, the world was growing at 86 million people a year. And for the first time, more than 50% of the world's population lived in cities. The projection is that by 2025, over 60% of the world's 8.3 billion people will live in urban areas. Wow, that is a lot of harvest. That is a lot of harvest, a lot of souls to be brought to the kingdom of God. Glenn Smith said in Louisiana World Post Archives, whether through migration or immigration, the socially dislocating experience of moving to a city tends to losing ties to local communities, and that opens the door for gospel. So when you find yourself in a city, when you meet someone else coming from maybe towns and they come to the city, the fact that they've disengaged with their background, looking for a better life in the city, becomes a very good opportunity, a striking point for us to bring the gospel to them. Because now they are not so weighed by the cultures and customs of where they are coming from. They see themselves in a new place where there's freedom, see themselves in a new place where they can embrace their own mind and their own thought process. And that moment, that kind of mindset gives us a fertile ground to preach the gospel. But we need to begin to take advantage of this. It is very important. It is very important. And then when we talk about the city, we've said a lot of things about how people are moving. We've said a lot of things about opportunities. It's important that we even look at some of these opportunities. The harvest is plentiful. We need to look at some of these opportunities and understand where we're fitting into these opportunities. So oftentimes people who move to the city are not just moving away from something. They are trying to move towards something as well. People are moving for change. They want new things. They want luxury. They want technological advancement, better way of life, better standard of living. Because of the strategic nature of cities, there is a lot of influence, business and finance, a lot of communication, technology, transportation, education, and a host of attractive things in this city. But as these things is attracting people to the city, God is expecting that his own children who have been well equipped will meet these people as they are coming in. Yes, they are coming in for education. Yes, they are coming in for a better way of life. But God is saying, how about my children? Offer them the best possible gift ever. And that is salvation. But then we can't do that if we are not conscious of the specific avenues that God has created in the city for us to witness. The first one I'll mention is the academia. I know that, at least from this part of the world, a lot of people on a yearly basis are trooping out to developed countries for their master's programs, bachelor's degrees, PhD programs, and people are moving to go and get better education in developed cities. But what God is saying is that as we continue to pursue your academic dreams, it is important that you also align to the purpose of God, which is that even those people in the academia get saved by you, God's own child. And so, for instance, you could be a graduate student, you've gotten teaching or research assistantship in a university, you're doing your master's program, fantastic. But how about you consider maximizing that avenue to preach gospel to the students within the departments and faculties you find yourself? Nothing stops you from initiating a small departmental fellowship. It could be one person, two persons you find that are like-minded like you. Start something. And from there, the fire of God comes upon it and it blows and becomes a wildfire of transformation, a wildfire of massive conversion of souls. But you have to take the decision to start. You need to be sensitive to the fact that, yes, I'm here for studies, but I'm also here as a missionary, as a representative of Jesus, as an ambassador of heaven. When that consciousness is in us, it means everything you do, whether you're in the lab doing research, you see opportunity to engage someone in a gospel conversation, you will not miss out on it. And so that is one of the biggest places where opportunities are bound for us to witness in the city. Another one I'll touch on is the professional corporate environment. Some of us find ourselves working in multinationals, in developed centers. We've mentioned how city brings people from diverse cultural background, diverse nationalities. When you find yourself in places like this, a multicultural, multinational organizations, corporate environment, you're in the banking sector, you're in the consulting sector, you are in the oil and gas energy sector, fantastic opportunity. But as you find yourself in that place, why don't you consider the possibility that God has brought you there, not just to bless you economically, yes, God wants to do that, but also to use you as an agent that will deliver people that are under oppression. Because the truth is, under the suit and the dressing you see in the corporate environment, there are a lot of heartbreaks, there are a lot of downtrodden people, there are a lot of depressed people who are under the oppression of the enemy. And God is saying, I've brought my child this opportunity, yes, to bless him economically, but also that my child becomes the agent of change, the salt that will transform this corporate environment, this organization. And so in those situations, God is saying, why don't you engage that colleague at the time you're working and just you see a downtime? Why don't you engage that colleague in a tactful gospel message? It could start by asking which church the person attends. Maybe you even know probably that the person is not a serious Christian or does not even attend church. But that initiates an open door to start a conversation. These are some moments that pass us by, but because we are not conscious, we don't take those opportunities. How about workplace fellowships? I know of places where Christian staff gather together to meet to pray about things in the organization. When we commit ourselves to participate or initiate and champion causes like this, by the time people in the organization are seeing the effect of the prayers, seeing the effect of the gathering, they would definitely be drawn to the aroma, the beautiful aroma of salvation in our lives. That is another avenue. And so when you come together to pray in those kind of places, you can strategize, you can plot mission outreaches, you can plot tactical approach to reach more people. And then we have business and trading. A lot of us are into trading. We go to cities to trade. We have shops. We have offices in the city. And people come to us every day. We have clients that come to trade, to transact business. It shouldn't be that your clients would come, spend minutes or hours in your office, and they leave and nothing lives with them spiritually. And they don't even hear the gospel message. Even if you don't preach the gospel message verbally, they can't see anything in your office world that challenges them, that brings their consciousness to the fact that there is a Jesus that can save them. Or your business card cannot find a way to communicate something about salvation. It could just be as simple as God loves you. Somewhere in your business card, somewhere on the wall of your office, somewhere in your shops. These things, we might take them for granted because Jesus has saved us. And so we feel God loves you seems normal. But that is a powerful word to someone who is going through depression. And that word could bring about a turnaround in their circumstances. And so you find yourself in business, we find ourselves in trading. We have ample opportunities because we interact with a lot of people daily, weekly. Let's create an environment. Let's create a structure that allows these people encounter the power of God through salvation. That is very important. And so sometimes verbally you communicate, but beyond the verbal, create a structure. Let your office not just be there with your business advertisement. Advertise Christ. That is what we are saying. Because God is saying, fine, you don't necessarily need to leave that business, that trading, to be a full-time missionary. But it's also saying that don't become a no-time missionary. Participate. Do your own part. Let your business integrate so much with the gospel. That is what God is asking and demanding for us. Some of us also find ourselves in sports, recreation, events. These are very good avenues where we can preach the gospel. Because in those events, people are more relaxed. People have come to, you know, while away time to refresh. So they might even be more open to listen to what you want to say about the gospel than maybe in an office environment. And so we go for these events, we go for these sporting activities. We need to leverage those opportunities to tell them about the gospel. Don't just go and relax and leave. Let that recreational activities give you an avenue to reach out to a soul who is more relaxed and more open to listen. Let us take good advantage of those kind of opportunities. So, another avenue we can use to reach out to people in urban centers is technology. I know a lot of us, we've heard so much about what technology is doing in this end time, technology everywhere. But have you ever considered how you can leverage technology to reach out to people in urban centers? Technology is advancing rapidly as Christians are migrating. There is internet available across everywhere. But how are you as a Christian leveraging internet? How are you leveraging technology? There is initiatives where people have gospel websites, radio stations, podcasts, and blogs. Very important and useful tools that you can actually use to speak and share the light of the gospel. Most urban dwellers are actually on the move. People are busy. And so to readily catch their attentions, you must leverage options that can reach them wherever they are. You must leverage options like the radio. And that is why we have the TKP radio that can reach out to you whether you are in your car or wherever you are. There are other avenues, there are promotional gospel adverts that you can consider. And so, you know, you're browsing, you're shopping, and you see adverts pop up on your webs, on your web page. These adverts are actually promotional materials that have been sponsored. As a child of God, you can go into that such that people are browsing, they're reading a page, and an advert just comes. What if the word ends today? Something that draws their attention to eternity. That is something that if you are gifted in technology or if you understand the power of technology, you can leverage to reach out to a lot of people. Pop-up adverts, Facebook, Google, these are avenues where we can actually, beyond just spending time to, as some people will say, catch crews and have fun, we can actually leverage those times we spend on the internet, on social media, to bring about salvation, to challenge people to seek the God we serve. And that is something we need to take seriously. Our interactions daily should bring about greater connection. People should not encounter us in a day and their spirit and soul is not challenged to think about eternity, to think about Jesus. That is something we need to take seriously. There is also the possibility to participate in community outreaches. Even in the cities, there are slums, there are communities that we can go to, that we can go to spread love and the gospel message. We can go to and reach out different medical outreaches, food outreaches, and in the process, we leave them with the message of love. We leave them with the message of salvation. These are different avenues through which we can spread the gospel message. Now, maybe you have been wondering, so we've talked about a lot of things along urban missions. You've been wondering, okay, so in this whole thing, who exactly can participate in urban missions? The Bible talks about beautiful feet. So maybe you've been thinking, who exactly and how do I find a place in this whole picture? That's something that's burning on your mind because you've seen the great opportunity that is in urban missions. That question will be answered. I'll be right back.
Can this be an option you have not considered? You find yourself in that city and you are so sure God led you there. Yes, He led you there in order to involve you in missions, not to exempt you. When you see the direction the Lord is going, wisdom demands that you queue up behind Him. Missions is a must for the church. It is the job for every believer. If you are not cut out for rural missions, you are unarguably designed for urban missions. Urban missions. Get involved. Get started.
Before we went on that break, we asked the question. I was discussing who in urban missions, and I was saying, for as many of us as you've been wondering, where do I fit in all this? How can I participate? There is this quote by P.F. Bersey. It says that we are debtors to every man to give him the gospel in the same measure in which you have received it. And then Davidson said, if you found a cure for cancer, won't it be inconceivable to hide it from the rest of mankind? How much more inconceivable to keep silent the cure for eternal wages of death? This one strikes me because indeed, picture if someone were to find a cure for cancer, for HIV, and the person just keeps it. A lot of people will be like, wow, this person is selfish, this person is evil. How much more the cure for the eternal damnation, the cure for eternal wages of death? We cannot afford to be quiet. And that is why Bill Sullivan is correct when he says that the evangelization of the world waits not on the readiness of God, but on the obedience of Christians. So the question is, will you be obedient? Will you release yourself and release the gospel in the measure to which it has been released unto you? Now, when we look at God's agenda for missions, for urban missions, the truth is that God is really pursuing with passion his worldwide purpose of gathering joyful worshipers for himself. And that is why we need to commit and connect into this agenda of God. We need to be light bearers. We need to bear the purpose, the mind of God in what we do, even in our daily vocation. So who exactly can participate in urban missions? The Bible talks about how beautiful are the feet of them that spread the gospel. You see, the truth is that absolutely everyone can and should participate in urban missions. So whether you're a professional, we've explained how you can find a place in urban missions. Your profession, your vocation gives you ample opportunity. Are you a businessman or a businesswoman? Fantastic. We've discussed how you can leverage your daily business activity, your trading activities to preach. Are you an immigrant or an expatriate that God has given a breakthrough opportunity to go to another country and work? Oh, absolutely great. You meet different people from different cultures and nationalities. Tell them about the gospel of Christ. You are a student. You meet a lot of people from different homes, broken backgrounds that need the saving power of salvation. We encounter them in our classrooms. We encounter them in the library. We encounter them in the hostel. Those opportunities, those avenues should not be lost. It is high time we understand that every waking moment that we have and that we are still living is an opportunity for us to add another soul to the kingdom of God. Artisans, retirees, clergy, artisans, a lot of your customers could come to you, fix their tires,
the plumber, they invite you to the house to fix something. Those encounters, as you enter those homes with the power of God and prayer, you can create a turnaround in that home you have gone to fix their air conditioner. You can create a lasting transformation in that house you've gone to fix their refrigerator.
When we see, as God sees, every situation in our lives, we begin to see limitless opportunities for the gospel.
So everyone has been given the potential for a beautiful fit to carry the gospel message. Will you choose to be one of those that God would really be able to say your feet is beautiful because of the message of salvation that you take around?
No Christian is left out of this great call. No Christian is left out of the commission mandate. And we must remember that it is only good news if it gets there in time. That was what John Piper said, and it's absolutely true. If you're preaching to a dead man, it's no more good news for the person because it's late. So it becomes good news when he reaches the destination, the target, at the right time. That is something that must spur us passionately to know that we do not have time. We should be fully fitted to every good work. And how we can prepare for band missions, how we can be fully fitted to every good work, first starts with a willing and an obedient heart. Isaiah 1:19. We need to be willing, we need to be obedient. And then we need to be fully fitted, like 2 Timothy 3:15 to 17 says, committing ourselves to study, making sure that we are workmen that need not reproved. We need to study to show ourselves approved. And one of those avenues is actually what we are having when we talk about people enrolling for Tent Makers Institute. That is one of the ways to study to show yourself approved, to give yourself to knowledge of the Word of God. Lay aside every weight and sin. These are things that slow us down on our mission assignment. Put on the whole armor of God. Ephesians 6:11-18 talks about the whole armor of God. You can't leave anyone out, because in your daily activities, the enemy will bring distractions, will bring different challenges that would want to, you know, knock you off yourselves. But when we kit ourselves with the whole armor of God of truth, salvation, the Word of God, which is the sword of the Spirit, you are able to overcome those distractions, those devices of the enemy, and you are able to send out the Word of God in power to everyone and those people you encounter on your daily activities. Also, it is important to have a compassionate heart, and I think this is very key for us in Christendom. The Bible recorded a number of times that Jesus would look at a crowd and he was moved with compassion for them. I think that is one of the essential requirements. If we are compassionate, we will be moved when we get to the market and we see multitudes that we don't know their salvation and eternal status. We will be moved when we get into our office and we see colleagues that we don't know their eternal status. So the Lord must give unto us a compassionate heart. We need to ask for it. We need to ask for it in prayers. And most importantly, above all, the Spirit of God. Isaiah 61:1-4 talks about the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And then we see the sequential transformation that the presence, the anointing, the impact of the Spirit of God upon a man does in the verses that follow, up to verse 4, where you talk about repairing ruined cities. So the Holy Spirit remains at the centerpiece of urban missions. If we give him allowance, if we give him space in our hearts, then he's able to walk through us and in us to bring about his intended purpose, which is that all men be saved. He's able to bring about that purpose to fulfillment in our activities. And the truth is that it is from Jerusalem to Judea to the rest of the world. So start where you are. As you're listening to this class, I don't know whether you're a student, whether you're a worker, God is saying you don't have to wait till I take you to Canada, to Europe. Start where you are right now and begin to proclaim the gospel of salvation. And as we wrap up, as I close, we need to avoid some pitfalls. First of all, we must understand that no matter the passion you have, by strength shall no man prevail. So it's not essentially in our own strength. Yes, God wants us to be compassionate, he wants us to be given to it, but we cannot do anything without the backing, the strength, and the wisdom of the Holy Spirit. Because the devil will bring situations that are complex than what your brain, your natural human mind can handle. So by strength shall no man prevail. We must always depend absolutely on God. We must know that there is no time. The Bible talks about, say ye not, therefore, there are yet 4 months. John 4:34-36. For the night cometh. We must also remember that Jesus said it. He said the night cometh. And so we must do everything we do with a sense of urgency that the night cometh. Don't finish this class and just go back to the norm thinking, okay, later in another 1 year or 2 years. Start now, the night cometh. You don't know whether that person God wants to use you
to deliver from eternal damnation. You don't know how many more days or hours the person has. The night comes. We must be conscious of that. We should not watch the wind. Don't watch the circumstances. He that watches the wind will not sow. We must ensure that right from wherever we find ourselves, favorable, seemingly unfavorable, we let it count for missions. And then, don't forget the message. It's all about Jesus. At the end of everything, the gospel message remains Jesus is the Savior of the world. That is the centerpiece of our message. Remember also that urban mission is not a one-time affair. It's not something you do today and you drop the dress tomorrow. It is consistently and continuously. It is not a one-time affair. The message is about Jesus. And as we do this, I'm sure that God begins to use us to bring transformation, massive transformation in our communities, in our cities, in our places. And what the Bible talked about in Jeremiah 29:7 will come to a reality. We begin to see peace. We begin to see progress. We begin to see restoration in our cities. And believe you me, when this happens, God is faithful. You will not be missing when the reward of the effort of your mission seeds begin to germinate. I trust that the Lord has raised a big challenge in our hearts today. And so we will be praying and we'll be asking God for one thing, that the Lord will commence an unquenchable passion and fire for urban missions in our hearts. That from this point, we no longer miss out on opportunities. That from this point, we no longer take for granted the daily avenue that God brings our way. That from this point, we no longer live as blind in the cities where there are so many souls in need of salvation. Let us speak to God. Let us ask God that He will strengthen our hearts, that He would draw us into an unquenchable passion and fire, that souls in our cities, souls that we encounter in our vocation, we preach the gospel to them. Thank you, Father, because you will do more than we can ask of you. We trust you that the fire you are lighting in us will last a lifetime. We trust you that we will not be silent in the face of souls perishing in our cities and urban centers. Thank you, Heavenly Father. For in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen.